satisfied as long as I am, dear Lord, close to me. Just a closer walk with thee. Granted, Jesus is my plea. Daily walking close to thee. Let it be, dear Lord, let it be. Now through this world of toils and snares, if I falter, Lord, who cares? Who is with me, burden shares? None but thee, dear Lord, none but thee. Just a closer walk with thee. Granted, Jesus is my plea. Daily walking close to thee. Let it be, dear Lord, let it be. When my feeble life is thy kingdom shore, thy Lord, to thy shore.
Just a closer walk with thee. Granted, Jesus is my
to Cowboy Church this morning. Please join me in prayer. Lord, thank you for the privilege to come into your house today, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that as we come into this place, our hearts are prepared to worship you, Lord. I pray, Lord, this morning that we have crucified our flesh so that our spirit may live. Lord, thank you for dwelling in our hearts and in this place. Lord, I pray that you open the eyes of our hearts this morning to receive your revelation knowledge. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Good morning. Ooh, it looks different out here. You're kind of in your same spots, though, sort of. It just looks so different. Looks great. Y'all like the seats? Isn't it great? They feel good on your back and your hiney. I almost said butt, but it almost come out. Anybody has any prayers, requests, any hallelujahs? Back.
A few weeks ago, Mr. Mike Stanford had told Mike and I that Priscilla's surgery is scheduled for tomorrow at the Cleveland Clinic over in Fort Lauderdale for her brain surgery. So just keep her lifted up. And Mr. Mike, actually.
All right. Anyone else? Yep. Trish?
I injured my foot really badly Friday, where I couldn't put weight or anything, excruciating pain. Saturday morning, I woke up and I was like, okay, well, maybe we're good. Was not good. I couldn't put any weight at all. And I'm laying in bed, and Frank and Cindy show up. They come and they pray over me, and Miss Cindy actually volunteered to take me to the doctor. A friend brought me crutches. And after they prayed, I'm like, I'm getting up. And so Miss Cindy tried to hand me my crutches, like, no, I'm getting up. And I got up, zero pain, completely healed, no problem, doing great.
Hallelujah. Anyone else?
Dane's on his way home from Tennessee, so we just want him to have a safe trip home.
All right. Anyone?
I have a prayer request. My brother-in-law recently has been experiencing some panic attacks, which is really unusual for him. I think he's only had two in his life within the last year. So if we could just keep him in our prayers. His name's Trent. Trent?
Anyone else? Everybody else? Everything's great. Going good. Praise God. I'm going to start out with a little devotion here I've got. And then we'll pray. So I'm going to encourage everybody. This is my devotion this morning. It was about resting in Jesus' finished work. And I love this scripture that it stands on. It's Ephesians 2. 7. But God, who is rich in mercy. Okay, stop right there. God, rich in mercy. Who else would you go to? Why are you going to go to yourself? God that is rich in mercy. Hallelujah. Because he is great love with which he loved us. Great love. A love for us. Up every morning and stand on that. Even when we were dead in trespasses, even when you screwed up yesterday or on the way to church or the day before, even though you've done things that wasn't like you know you probably should have not done, I'm guilty. I have my days, my moments. But thank you. Even then, he makes us alive together with Christ, the anointed one. By grace, you have been saved. Thank you. You have go back to that. You have to go back with Christ and raised us up together. Now, together with Christ. You're not in this by yourself. And made us sit together in the heavenly place in Christ, in his power, that in the ages to come, he might show the exceeding riches of his grace, his unmerited for us, our undeserved, unearned favor for us. In his kindness, he is kind to you. Don't lean on yourself. You're going to fail. In his kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. Am I not working? My battery's dying. I drank Mountain Dew. I don't know why. It means that today we are in a position of rest in Jesus' finished work. Are you doing this? We need to make sure that we think about what his finished work is, and we're sitting with him. We are seated with Christ, so we should be in rest, trusting him, relying on Jesus for his good success in every area of our lives. Meditate on that. It's Jesus. It's all about Jesus. It's about Christ himself in us. To be seated in Christ is to rest and to trust in him and to receive everything our beautiful Savior has accomplished on our behalf. But instead of looking at Jesus, believers are misled by the devil into looking at themselves. Satan will point out, the devil's strategy is to point out all of our flaws, our weaknesses, our mistakes, our blemishes. He keeps reminding us of our failures, the things we did in the past. By the time you think you're over it, here it comes again. is brought up into your mind, and then you mully grub on that. Instead of looking, actually, we should be looking down, because if we're up seated with Christ, we are in the heavenlies. We are seated with him and beside him. So we need to focus on these things. We need to be resting on these things. In Christ, we're accepted before God. Because as Christ is, so are we in this world. That is in 1 John 4:17. We must stand on him. We got to stand in his sweetness and his goodness in our lives. So wake up in the morning. Don't be looking at yourself. Forget yesterday's gone. Today's a brand new day. You start praising God for that moment you got to wake up. So right now I'm going to pray. Father God, I praise you for each and every person in here. We have gathered together, Lord. I pray that each and every person in here has your salvation for them. I pray that we're walking in the rest through Jesus Christ, in Jesus. I pray, Father God, that the words that are spoken in here are received like sweet honey, Lord God, that the living water of your word just refreshes us to Father God. I praise you and I thank you. I thank you for the healing in Trisha's foot, Lord God. I thank you that as Mike goes through this surgery, that, Lord God, that all healing shall happen quick. I pray that your total and complete healing happens for him and with him, and all the people that are involved in his life, Lord God, are encouraging and concerned and rest in you, Christ. I pray, Father God, for Trent, for the prayers that he needs, the strength and the guidance that he needs in his life. I pray for each and every person in here that has a sorrow, a heaviness, any guilt, any condemnation. I rebuke those right now in the name of Jesus, and we stand on the word of God. I praise you, Father God, for everyone in here that your anointing is on them. I thank you, Lord, for your wisdom, your kindness, your gentleness, and your graciousness toward us, your mercy to help us in our time of need. Lord God, I thank you that your grace is with us, that we sure don't deserve it, Lord God, but I sure praise you for that gift, the gift of grace, the gift of your righteousness, the gift of your faith that you give us. I praise you, Father God, that you give us the strength and the power to walk on in your name, that when we don't know what to do, we can call upon your wisdom. I praise you, Father God, that this is the day that you have made for us, and because of you, we can lean on you and walk on with you. We are not in this alone. Hallelujah. I praise you, God, for all depression to cease right now on your people. It has no place on your people. I rebuke depression on everyone, oppression. I loosen that from them, and I loosen peace and glory and God's goodness, Lord God. I praise you that you are our Father, our friend, and our judge, and you judge righteously. You are kind. Thank you, Lord. We call upon your correction, your protection, your direction in our life, and your perfection working within us, leaning on you and only you. I thank you, Father, for your Son, and we are able to have that relationship with you. In the name of Jesus, amen. Mm-hmm. So today I want you to repeat. I like this. This is on my heart. I like this. I said this last Sunday. All right. So when I say it, you repeat it. I am greatly blessed.
I am.
I am highly favored.
I am highly favored.
And I am deeply loved.
And I am deeply loved.
Amen.
You'll please stand.
All of creation and all of the earth, make straight a highway, a path for the Lord. Jesus is coming soon. Call back the sinner and wake up the saint. Let every nation shout of your fame. Jesus is coming soon. Like a bride waiting for her groom, we'll be a church ready for you. Every heart longing for our King, we sing, even so come, Lord Jesus, come. Even so come, Lord Jesus, come. There will be justice and all will be new. Your name forever, faithful and true. Jesus is coming soon. Like a bride waiting for her groom, we'll be a church, we'll be ready for you. Every heart longing for our King, we sing, even so come, Lord Jesus, come. Even so come, Lord Jesus, come. So we wait for you. So we wait, you're coming soon. Jesus, we wait for you. God, we wait, you're coming soon. Like a bride waiting for her groom, we'll be a church, we'll be ready for you. Every heart longing for our King, we sing. Every heart waiting for her groom, we'll be a church, ready for you. Every heart longing, so come, Lord Jesus, come. Even so come, Lord Jesus, come. Even so come, Lord Jesus, come. So come, Lord Jesus, come.
There I was, empty-handed, crying out from the pit of my despair. There you were, in the shadows, holding out your hand, you met me there. And now where would I be without you? Where would I be, Jesus? You were the voice in the desert, calling me out in the dead of night, fighting my battles for me. You were my rescue story, lifted me up from the ashes,
carried my soul from death to life, bringing me from glory to glory. You are my rescue story. You are my rescue story. You are. You were writing the pages before I had a name, before I needed grace. Singing songs of redemption every time I ran away. You were louder than my shame. And now where would I be without you? Where would I be, Jesus? You were the voice in the desert, calling me out in the dead of night, fighting my battles for me. You were my rescue story. You lifted me up from the ashes and carried my soul from death to life, bringing me from glory to glory. You were my rescue story. You never gave up on me. You never gave up on me. You were my testimony. Oh, you never gave up on me. Oh, you never gave up on me. You were my testimony. Oh, you never gave up on me. No, you never gave up on me. This is my testimony. You were the voice in the desert, calling me out in the dead of night, fighting my battles for me. You were my rescue story. You lifted me up from the ashes and carried my soul from death to life, bringing me from glory to glory. You were my rescue story. You are, you are. You are my rescue story. You are, you are. You are my rescue story.
Take what is, and you make it beautiful. When love floods in, we're restored forevermore. The dead to life, with words that pierce the dark with light. Only by the blood are we set free. With mercy strong to carry shame and nail it to a tree, you alone hold the power to redeem. No guilt competes with innocence crucified. No grave can hold what your grace has justified.
With bread that brings the dead to life, with words that pierce the dark with light, only by the blood are we set free. With mercy strong to carry shame and nail it to a tree, you alone
your eyes to see. With every morning light, again we are redeemed. Rejoice, O child of God. Lift your eyes to see. With
this morning.
Jesus blinded all my darkness. He sparked my heart within. His grace and mercy lit a passion, consumed my sin. Now like a city on a hilltop, I'll shine through the night. I am a light made for His glory, I will not hide. I've been touched by a fire, so let the whole world come and watch me burn. Shout it from the rooftops, shout it till everyone has heard. This love will never be extinguished. It's alive and wild and free. I'm overtaken by His power. His Spirit in me. His Spirit is me. His Spirit in me. I've been touched by a fire, so let the world come and watch me burn. Shout it from the rooftop, shout it till everyone has heard. Jesus has changed my life, His name be lifted high. His healing fire's burning inside of me. Jesus has changed my life, His name be lifted high. This holy fire's burning inside of me. I cannot hold it inside, I cannot keep it quiet. This holy fire's burning inside of me. I cannot hold it inside, I cannot keep it quiet. This holy fire's burning inside of me. I've been touched by a fire, so let the world come and watch me burn. Shout it from the rooftop, shout it till everyone has heard. I've been touched by a fire, so let the world come and watch me burn. Shout it from the rooftop, shout it till everyone has heard. I cannot keep it quiet. This holy fire's burning.
Shout it from the rooftops. Shout it till everyone has heard.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, band. Great job again. Oh, yeah, let me turn that on for you, baby. There it went. Now, can you hear? You got
testing, testing.
Testing, 1, 2, 1, 2. You got you? All right, ready to go. Okay. What do you think now? All right. We got two or three people that likes it. All right. That's good. I'm thinking that the good part about it is because, like I said, I'd sit in those benches on Tuesday nights, and James will carry you for a little ride on Tuesday night, and it'll last for about 2 hours. So by the time you sit in that pew for about 2 hours, you got to try to find every kind of spot you got because you done found them all. They done sold. But we got the opportunity to sit in these yesterday for a couple of hours, and it was nice. So here's what I share with you. I was going to bring a hot shot with me this morning because I got a feeling that it's going to feel so good that you're going to have a tendency to want to doze off. But here's what I share with you. It's okay, just lay over. Don't doze, just lay over. It looks better. So if we happen to go a little bit long and you feel the need to rest, just lay over. Enjoy. I hope you enjoy the chairs for sure. Let me share with you a little bit about the announcements. Don't forget about dinner will be served. They're served every Tuesday now, but the first and the third Tuesdays are just for ladies. So they make that pasta stuff, and that's when I don't come. They tried to get me over there one time for that. Told me they were having beef stew or something. We got over there and they having something else. I had to leave. But anyhow, get with Miss Diane or Miss Beck, one of them, but. Send them and let them know you're coming so they can make sure they got plenty. And then remember the women's Bible study this Tuesday, the 19th, the title of the book, The Bait of Satan. And believe me, his bait is getting more richer and more enticing every day. So if you know what the bait is, and I love this because I truly believe, I hadn't read the book, but I love the title, and I truly believe that it's going to give you an eye-opening, because if you do not know what the enemy's putting before you, you'll take the bait every single time. But when you know what the bait is, then you can avoid the bait. Amen? So come be a part of that, as Diane and Beck carry that off. And then then we're back here again on the 24th, and don't forget about the Bible study. We got kids in here, and Miss Lily is stepped into that role, and she had a house full this morning. So at 9:45, the kids are meeting in here. The ladies are meeting over in the first barn, and then the men are in the second barn. And so, again, if you want to be a part of that, please come. You'll be blessed by that. Great ministry going on there as well. And then on the 14th, we'll be at both places. We're here at 11, Venus at 10. And then the practice pen, we're all for this month and the next, and then should start back in September. Baptism, next Sunday, we're having baptism. Now, if anybody else wants to get baptized, see me or James today so we can have you ready for next Sunday. So it's because we'd like to talk with you just a little bit. And then this is one you want to make sure you write down. Worship night, Saturday, July 30th at 6:30 p.m. Come, and all you're going to do is listen to the music. You got a good place to sit, and they're going to just play music. You ain't got to worry about me getting up here preaching. I ain't going to preach. It's just going to be worship. You worship this through the songs and let the songs worship in you. Amen? So come be a part of that. Invite people. Invite them to come. Tell them you got a good seat for them to sit in and let them come on. And then the third annual Complete Women's Conference is coming up. Saturday, November the 5th from 9 to 2. So you want to be a part of that as well. Very powerful, powerful thing. Don't forget about the tables in the back, the round tables in the back. Anything you find back there now is for you. It's provided by the church for you to have to be able to carry, to give to other folks, or use for yourself. So please, and we steadier. When you take it, don't worry. There's more. We got it in the storage back there. So if it's the last one, get it. We'll put more out. So again, remember that. And right off the press, on the 31st of this month, which will be the last Sunday of July, baby dedication. And I've got one baby already lined up. So if there's any more that would like to do that, please get with me. But the 31st is baby dedication. And then another thing I want to share with you that the Lord laid on my heart during my prayer time, and he began to share it with me earlier, but he made it very precise that I needed to do it today, and I did that this morning. So every chair that's in this place, that's in the children's room, that's over in the, we've got some chairs over in the ladies and the men, have all been anointed with oil. So when you sit there, and they were anointed with frankincense and myrrh, and understand that, that means the favor of God. So when you sit in that chair, you know that the favor of God is among you because it's been anointed. All you got to do is accept it, receive it, and walk out of here with it. Amen? All for you. And I done it in the cushion so it would not be able to get away. Amen? So that's, I wanted to share that with you. And then the Wigglesworth Thought of the Week. The greatest gift now, the greatest gift of mankind is to be able to say, Christ lives in me. Amen? Amen. Does he live in you today? Okay, half of you. I'll get it all out of you before it's over with. So say, Christ. Come on now. Come on, wake up. I done dozing on me. Christ, there we go, lives in me. Hallelujah. There you go. All right, back to the book of Revelation again. And I really believe, and I could be wrong, I might be overstepping my boundaries here, but I really think this is going to be the last Sunday in Revelation. I don't think the Lord's going to let me go any further than this. But I could be wrong. We get back here next Sunday and he got me back to Revelation. That's fine. But anyhow, we're leaving out of the church age part of it, and we're stepping into after the church has been raptured. And I'm going to share a little bit about that today. But we're going to go back to Revelation, and we're going to look in chapter 1, verse 19 to start with. Just one verse. I want to read that real quick. This is what Jesus has shared here. And Revelation 1, verse 19. Let me make sure I got the right one wrote down here. Now, I may have wrote the wrong one down for myself. Well, anyhow, that was not the right one, so scratch that. And I don't want to spend time looking for it. I just want you to realize that what Jesus is about to do now, and Revelation is cut up into three parts. It's cut up into the past, which is in the first chapter of Revelation. Then you got the present, which is in chapters 2 through 3. And then from chapters 4 on to chapter 22, it talks about the future. Okay? So so understand that. So chapter 1 is about the past, things that have happened in the past. And then chapters 2 and 3 take care of the present time. And as we talked about this last Sunday we were here, and we talked about the last church, and we're believing that is the church of this age now. So the present time. But now we're going to look into the future just a little bit. Because, again, knowing that the future is brighter than what it looks like. Okay? Because if you'll look at the future of the Bible and not look at the future of the world, you'll understand that it's a little bit brighter. But if you decide that you're going to just dwell on the world and what's going on there, your future will not look pretty at all. Amen? It don't look very good when you look at it from that perspective. But you look at it from God's perspective and realize and remember now, just like I told you earlier, that chair's been anointed with the oil of His favor. So you got to know that you know when you walk out of here today that I have God's favor on me. Amen? And you have to proclaim that. You have to tell yourself that. Even when the storm is coming, when the storm's all amongst you, whenever it's pouring out on you, when you can't seem to even, you've been in those rains where you got your windshield wipers running just as hard and fast as you can, and you still can't see. That's what kind of storm I'm talking about. But you got to understand this. You still proclaim, you still know that you got the favor of God on you, and He will get you through to the other side. Amen? He don't want you to quit. He don't want you to stop. That's what the enemy wants. The enemy's trying to get you to stop right where you're at. The enemy's trying to get you to quit right where you're at. But he said, don't you do that because your future is bright because of me. Amen? So as we begin to look now, I want to just unveil this to you the best I can in the time that we have. And in Revelation chapter 4, again, we begin now. And from chapter 4 on, the church has been removed out of it. That's the reason they say that this is chapter 4 represents or pictures the rapture of the church. And some of you may say, well, I can't find rapture in the Bible. And you're right. You will not find it in the English. If you go back to the Greek, you will find it. But understand this. It was wrote first in the Greek. Then it went from the Greek to the Latin, and when they took it from the Greek to the Latin, they kind of took rapture and replaced it, but when it went from Latin to English, they removed rapture out. That's why we don't see it and in the Bible. You've got to go back to Greek, you've got to go back into that and study that, and you'll find that part. Now, they've got words in here talking about called up, called out, lifted up. That's what he's trying to get. That's the future that you have as a believer, okay? Not as a non-believer, but as a believer, you have that for yourself. So listen to what it says as I begin now in chapter 4, verse 1. It says, after these things I looked, and behold, a door standing open in heaven. And the first voice which I heard was like a trumpet speaking with me, saying, come up here. And I will show you things which must take place after this. Okay, remembering, he's brought us to there, brought us to the part about understanding about the church age, where we are today. Now he's telling, now I'm going to let you know what's about to happen yet to come. And realizing that John in this represents the church. Okay, so if you see John, now this is John. Remember, John's the one that's writing this. So he looked and behold, and the first voice that he heard was like a trumpet. What does the Bible say that every ear will hear? The trumpet sound. Okay? So the trumpet sound is the sound of Jesus. When you hear his voice, it'll sound like a trumpet. It'll make you come to attention. And because anytime you've ever been around, and I know you've been around from time to time, and you hear the trumpet sound, it brings you to attention. It just automatically makes you just come to attention. That's the kind of voice that you're going to hear from Jesus. You're not going to have to wonder, is that him or not? No, I promise you, I don't care how, and this is what I want to share with you. I don't care how far you've drifted away from Jesus. You'll know that you know when you hear that sound, it's him. There'll be no doubt in your mind. Now, lost folks won't have a clue. They won't have a clue because they won't have ears to hear. Why Jesus says, let your ears, let you be able to hear what the Word of God says. Open your ears so you can hear, not listen. We listen a lot, but we don't hear much. Amen. When we stop, and that's something that I've been working so, so hard on. I've been listening to a book on a servant. I probably listened to that thing about 7-8 times now. And it's so powerful, and that's one of the key things in there, and one of my biggest weaknesses I had to work on was being willing to listen or hear, Not just listen, because if you listen, all you're doing is listening for some way you can get and interject in there and stop them and be rude to them, and you don't even realize it. But when you hear, you'll sit there and be patient and hear every last word they've got to say. Never say a word till they're completely done, and then let the Holy Spirit go from there. Because you'll be able to talk to them in a way that you would not have talked to them before. Because why? Because you let your flesh get in the way. Amen? But when you let the Spirit lead you, you'll share with them what they need to hear. That may not be what they want to hear, but it'll be what they need to hear. So again, you're going to know that you know that trumpet sound. And when that trumpet sound, and then listen, he said, come up here. And that's what Jesus is going to say. He's going to say, when he trumpet sounds, that's his next word. Come up here. You ain't got to worry about him coming to the ground. You're going to meet him in the sky. Amen? And if you're close to if you're close to a graveyard, I'm trying to get the right word out. If you're close to a graveyard now, just get ready. They coming up out of the grave, all right? They coming up before you are. You're going to wonder, what in the world is that going up in the air? Take the grave clothes off of them. When they get to Jesus, the grave clothes will be off. They'll have a new body, and they'll be ready to go. And then guess what? We're going to meet with them there. Amen? That's what the future looks like for you. That's why it's so bright. And again, whenever you understand what you're about to go, what it's about to talk, and what it's about to unveil to you from chapter 4 down to chapter 22, you don't want to be a part of that. And I truly believe God has no reason for us to be a part of that. Whenever you read into it, there's a lot of folks that you got the tribulation, some's pre, some's middle, some's post, I guess you call it. I believe in pre. I don't believe God wants me to go through what he's going to dish out. Believe that's what many believe, that we will not go through that. God will let us. And here's what I want to share with you, because here's the thing you got a decision to decide to make. Do you want to stand down here on the front lines where it's going to be happening, or do you want to be like me? I'm going to be up in the balcony of heaven watching. Amen. You got a choice, whether you want to stand up in the balcony of heaven and watch what's happening, or you want to be on the front line down here in the midst of what's happening. The decision's up to you. Amen? Now, if you're born again believer, guess what? You're going to be in the balcony and being happy to be there. Matter of fact, even in the nosebleed section, you'll be happy. Amen? Amen. Cindy and I went, one time we was in Vegas, I shared this with you because, I mean, And if you ever been up in a nosebleed session, we was up in Vegas there one year, and we didn't have tickets, so we just got a random ticket, and we did. We went all the way to the top, the very top, where all the smoke rises to, and all the heat rises to, and the chairs ain't very comfortable neither. And we sit up there, and she couldn't stand it. She had to come down. She said, "I got to get out of here. I can't handle this heat, this thing." So Jed traded with her. But I promise you, when you get up in the balconies of heaven, there ain't gonna be no smoke to be worried about. Be clear vision for you. Amen. All the way to the bottom. So again, if we go on now, he said, come up here and I will show you the things which must take place. Now, when you go back and you read in the book of Revelation, in all the way from Genesis right on through, and you see that everything that God said did come to pass. Amen. Prophecy after prophecy after prophecy was fulfilled. And Jesus came along and fulfilled all the ones up to now. So you know that whenever God says, come up here, I got to show you what's about to happen, it's going to happen. It ain't, I ain't sure it's going to happen. Are you sure that it's going to happen? Well, the Bible says it is, so you take it up with God. I'm going to go by what he said. Whenever he said to Abraham about Sodom and Gomorrah, and Abraham went to him and pleaded with God, all the way down to when you get to 10. God, if it's just, if we can find 10, will you not? And God said, yeah, I won't if there's 10, if you can find. But he couldn't find but 4, and one of them turned back. But realizing God would have spared Sodom and Gomorrah if he could have found 10. Okay? But he couldn't find 10, so he had to stay at his word. So you know that he's going to stand on his word. When you read the things that's going to happen in tribulation, you're thinking, oh my gracious, oh my. Exactly, you're right, oh my. It will be bad. They ain't nothing ever will be seen on, nothing we can even begin to fathom will come close to what will happen. Because, again, first of all, imagine this, and we've talked about this a little bit before. Imagine this happening. Every Christian moved out. Every Christian, first of all, taken out. Guess what that does? That takes the Holy Spirit out. Then you'll begin to see just how rampant things are. It's us as believers praying and pleading with God. It's helping this thing still stay together. Amen? Don't think that whenever you come to the word, go come to the very throne of God, and you come there with boldness, you come there with expectation, you come there because you're favored, you come there because you're his child, you come there because you're loved, you come there because he's a good father, you come there because he loves you and that's who he is and who you are. When you come that way and you plead like you do with Abraham, you don't think it ain't keeping things from going bad, whenever you hear and you see and understand what continues to go on. That's the only reason. But you imagine what it is whenever he pulls that out. And it would be, again, no one, the Holy Spirit will not be there to convict, to help. He'll let them run rapid. So as we go on now, if we understand that, and I hope you understand that about the rapture. That's what verse 1 looks like, just a picture of us being lifted up from earth up into heaven. And then in verse 2, immediately I said, I was in the spirit, and behold, a throne set in heaven, and one sat on the throne. So again, whenever you think about this, about the spirit now, you got to think about and understand this is a state of heightened spiritual sensitivity. The closer you come with Jesus, the more you get to know who the Holy Spirit is in you, and realizing he is a he, not a it, and you begin to allow that Spirit to move and take you to places you never thought you could ever go to, allowing you to do things you never thought you could do. That's what he's talking about, carrying you to a place of such sensitivity that you know. And I share this with you because, and this is something that James shared on Tuesday night that sparked something in me, and he didn't even realize that he was doing it, but it was something that brought a different type of prayer to my life as I prayed and laid my hand upon Trisha's foot yesterday. I put it underneath the bottom and on top of it. But as James was saying, when you pray with faith and know, when you lay your hands on it, the faith of the Lord Jesus is going about to flow out of you and into that object that you're praying for, whoever that may be, whatever that may be, you'll pray different. And that's exactly what happened whenever I laid my hands on her yesterday and prayed for her. And because my wife was the one that got us to go. It wasn't me. Was it me? Oh, let me go pray for her. No. She said, we need to go by there. I'm saying, okay. You know, just I'm being honest. You know what I'm saying? And sometimes you got to listen to your wives. Amen. Okay, thank you. But realizing, and say, so we got there, you know, and then it was all of a sudden, and I should have been, because I'm the pastor, you know, I should have been the first one to say, hey, let's lay hands, because she was laying in the bed. We got in there. She was in the kids' room, laying in the bed. Poor thing ain't had no shower, no nothing. And she probably didn't want me to share all that. But anyhow, she laying in the bed, and you could see her foot was, you know, where it swelled and all that. And she said, now, and I share this with you. She was in such excruciating pain earlier, and James and the kids prayed for her, I guess that night before, and the pain left, okay? But she could not get up and put weight on it. She could lay there fine, no pain, but when she put weight on it, whew, she couldn't stand it. So somebody brought her a pair of crutches. So I'm sitting there, you know, we're getting ready. You know, we're sitting there talking with her and all that. And realizing, my wife said, okay, we're going to pray for you. I should have been the one to say, we're going to pray for you. But I didn't. That's what she said. But I remembered the words that James told me. So before I laid my hands on there, my faith rised up inside of me in such a way that I knew when I laid my hands on her, healing was going to take place. Because it was the power of Jesus about to escalate his power through me into her. And I knew me, but it had me putting my faith in him, not in myself, but in him, that his healing was about to move through me and into her foot. Amen? And that's exactly what happened. She got up and started walking around crying. Crying. Yeah, just so crying. Just I'm no pain. I'm all right. And then she come back. And here's what I share with you here. I love this about what she done after that. She come back to me. She said, I still got a little bit of pain in one spot. Will you pray with me again? I said, absolutely. Don't you dare. Whenever you get prayed for healing, you accept every last bit of your healing. Don't you walk out of there still feebled. Because I shared in our prayer, and the Lord just laid this on my heart. When he brought all the ones out of Israel, there was not one feeble one in there. God doesn't want her to be feeble with 9 children. Come on. So I knew that, and I'm praying that, and I'm reminding God of that. Amen. Sometimes we got to remind God, just like the rainbow, okay? It ain't for what they think it is. Amen? The rainbow is a reminder to God that he will not flood the earth again. Even though they try to ridicule it and make it into something else, that's not what it is. So they're mocking God. They'll answer to that one day. They will answer to it. So again, let me get on. But I share that with you because I hope that will spur up something in you. Because remember what Jesus said, it's his faith that he's put in us, and he wants to begin it and finish it, perfecting it in us. Amen? But you got to be willing to go up there and know when you put your hands on her, healing's coming. Because your God does not lie. Amen? Okay, let me go on. So, in verse 3 it says, now, he who sat there was like a jasper and a sardis stone in appearance. And there was a rainbow around the throne and the appearance like an emerald. So I want you to stop here and think about it. Now, the jasper represents the diamond. So purity and wholeness. So as he was brought to the throne, he began to see God, and this is what it looked like. It's the best thing he could explain it. He said, I can't explain what God looks like, but I'm just going to share with you like this, and that's the best I can do. You're just going to have to see it for yourself. Amen? So when you see God and you know that, the first thing you can imagine is a diamond. And what do they say? So you want to know why ladies are more attracted to God than men? God just laid this on my heart. Because the ladies, that diamond is a lady's best friend. Amen? Okay. So again, you think about that. So because why? Because it's purity and holiness. And that's exactly what ladies want from their men. Purity and holiness. And then he goes on, now the sardis is a deep red. So this is God's avenging wrath coming to life. Okay? That's what you see there, and understand that. And then the other one is the emerald green, which is the dominant color in the rainbow, all right? The dominant color in the rainbow symbolizing mercy. Amen? Aren't you thankful for God's fresh anointing mercy every morning you wake up? Then we go on. Let me carry on now. So it says around the thrones were, well, verse 4, around the thrones were 24 thrones, and on the thrones I saw 24 elders sitting clothed in white robes, and they had the crowns of gold on their heads. And if we begin to see this, it just represents the redeemed. That elders represents everyone who's been redeemed, all right? So when you imagine that and you see that and you think about that, that's exactly where you'll be as a believer. You'll come into the midst of that because you've been redeemed by the blood of Jesus. Amen? And it, so again, it just shows you that, and then brings, lets you understand it's glorified and it's enthroned. So again, all you're going to see is the glory of God in the midst of that. That's why you got to understand John, he said he was caught up in the Spirit. His spirit left his body, okay, to be a part of this. Because, and understand this, that's why you have to, and I got people looking at me crazy now, but listen to me good. Because this is why we die and our body stays here in the grave and our spirit leaves. Because guess what? We're getting a new body. This body we got could never even begin to stand before God. Amen? Because remember what he told Moses. He said, there's no way you can look at me and live. Now, do you think you're going to get into heaven and he's going to put blinders on you where you can't see God when he's been waiting so long to walk with you? He's going to make your body where you can walk in the midst of him and the light of him will not do nothing but just glow through you. Amen? That's the kind of body he's talking about you're going to get. So the old body will be gone. Now you go, so that's why John couldn't be caught up with his body. He would have never survived, but his spirit will. Amen. So again, and that's what you see there. So I want you to realize that. So whenever we meet him in the air, that's when we got that new body comes and we're able to be in the midst with him. So then it goes on and talks about the crown. Now the white robes, you understand that as being purity. So again, understanding whenever you have been gave, you got, and that robe of righteousness, it only fits you. It will not fit your spouse. You cannot give it to your kids. You cannot give it to a stranger. Jesus hands out the robe of righteousness for you, fitted for you. It will not fit anybody else. Amen? That's why God doesn't have no grandchildren. He only has children. So when you think about that robe of righteousness that he puts on you, that's just that purity. He has washed you, cleansed you of all your sins. Amen? Ain't nothing no greater to know that when you come before God, he's got that robe of righteousness on you and he sees your sins no more. Amen? So then he goes on and realizing that the crowns that they're talking about, crowns are victory and joy. Not like we think today, not, but these crowns that have been placed on you is from victories, from the victories that we've had here on earth, victories that we've had over the enemy, victories that God brought you into a trial, and you come out the other side, and guess what? You won. Because why? Because you had Jesus on your side. Amen? But you had to run the race. You had to do it. They don't give prizes away for those sitting on the bench. Amen? I never seen nobody sitting on a bench that ever got a prize. But when they're in the race and they're running the race, there's where you get the prize because they finished the race. Amen? And God means to you to get in the race, get in the race, get in the race, because he'll help you finish the race so you can have the crown that you can place at the feet of Jesus because you've done it all for him. Amen? Because he gave it all for you. Amen? Okay, let's go on real quick. All right, now at verse 5 it says, and from the throne proceeded lightning and thundering and voices. And you got to stop right there because I want you to realize and understand this. Every time you hear lightning or you see lightning or you hear thunder, what does that remind you of? A storm's on the way. Amen? Every time. If I get to hearing around here, I go to praying. Pushing it away, praying to push. Sometimes I don't pray with the right kind of faith and it comes right on me. But there's times when I'll pray and I'll push and I'll plead with God, and God will separate it and bring it around us. People will be flooded on all sides, and we'll be when I come with that kind of faith. Now, and you look at me like I'm crazy or whatever, but I've done it over and over again, and I've watched you do it. So I've come to believe and know if I'll get out there in faith, I can help keep the rain from coming here and settling here and dropping a tremendous amount. And then from time to time, he'll show me the rainbow. And I say, thank you, Lord, because I needed you to show me that, because I could see that. And know, because sometimes it'll start getting deep around here. You know what I mean? And I need to know that. Okay, Lord, that's it. That's good. You reminded me again. You ain't going to flood it. It's looking like it, but you ain't. But anyhow, so as we begin to think about that, you remember the lightning and the thunder. And again, knowing that the storm is coming. Knowing and realizing the storm's coming. So what do? You got two choices. You either come against it and you put up against it, or you tuck your tail and run. And so many times the enemy wants to tell you, tuck your tail and run. Tuck your tail and run. Do like everybody else is doing. Tuck it and run. I've been out here at the arena at times, and I'm praying for the rain to go away, and I'm on my horse, and I'm watching the rain, and the lightning's just popping everywhere. And I wouldn't let anybody else be out there, but I'm riding my horse out there because I'm riding in faith, believing and trusting in God that he's going to keep the rain off so those kids can rope. Not for me. I ain't roping. I'm just out there with them. But I'm riding and I'm believing. They're in the trucks and it's right there. You can see it all the way around. It's lightning flashing, all that. And God will push it around and they'll get to rope. But I got to come with that kind of faith, believing and knowing I've done it, that he will do that for me. That's the kind of God we got. But when's the last time you asked him in such a way like that? Amen. Let me go on, because I see y'all wallering a little bit in the seats, getting a little restless. So let me hurry up now. So again, as we see that in the power of that approaching storm. So some of you's in a storm. I talked to a lady this morning. That's exactly where she's at. And every time before, we're going to find ways to get out of the storm. We're going to find ways to fix it so I don't have to go through the storm. But God's saying, some of y'all got to understand this. In order to get where you're going to get, in order to get the prize that he has for you, you got to go through that storm first. And there are going to be times whenever you're going to look back and you're going to remember that, as I shared with her, remember the footprints in the sand. There's only one set of footprints. What did Jesus do? Quit you? No. He toted you. Amen? And that's when you see him carrying you, getting you through till you get to the other side. He means for you to get out to the other side. He means for you to get out of the boat and get on the water whenever it don't look right. He means for you to do that. But you got to trust in him. You got to put your faith in him. Who are you going to believe in? You going to believe in yourself, or you going to believe in God? You going to trust in yourself, or you going to trust in God? Because if you trust in yourself, guess what? You're going to sink every time. Ask Peter. But when you trust in God, you'll walk on top of the water. You'll do things you could never do without God. Amen? But you got to come to a place where you're ready to trust him, ready to put your faith into gear, and ready to move that muscle and get started doing things God wants you to do. All right, let me go on. It goes on. It said the seven lamps were burning before the throne, which the seven spirits of God. Again, we're just talking about the Holy Spirit here whenever you see the seven. Holy Spirit being complete, the Spirit of God. And then it goes on in verse 6. Before the throne was a sea of glass like crystal. And again, giving you that visual of what it looks like. And in the midst of the throne and around the throne were four living creatures full of eyes in front and in back. So don't you think, now listen to me right here, I want you to understand this. You're seeing things, you're hearing things on TV, you're seeing things, you're watching things, you're seeing them on your phone, and you're thinking, how are they getting away with that? They're not. That right there tells you. Them eyes will not let anything get by. Amen. Let me go on. Then he goes on and says, and in the midst of the throne, okay, verse 7. The first living creature was like a lion. Jesus was what? The Lion of Judah. The second living creature was like a calf or an ox. Jesus had that kind of power and that kind of strength, that kind of authority. And then again, we go to the third living creature like the face of a man. Jesus came in human form. Amen. And then the other one was, the creature was like a flying eagle, realizing that means speed. It also means that he rules. So So when you see that, he's talking. That's what he's sharing with us there. That's another picture of Jesus. And that's the best. And he's trying to explain that. Again, not like you've seen him in the Gospels. This is a whole different picture that he wants you to see him as now. Just as you've seen yourself before you were a believer, now you should see yourself different as a believer. Amen? And then it goes on to say, and then the four living creatures, each having six wings, were full of eyes around and within, and they do not rest day or night. So what happens at night, he still sees. What happens during the day, he still sees. And then he goes on saying, holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, who was and who is and who is to come. Man, if you'll come on now, please. I want you to think about this. That as you think about the holy part, here's two ways of seeing this holy. So holy is the God of the past. Holy is the God of the present. And holy is the God of the future. Amen? Or you could see it like this. Holy is the Father. Holy is the Son. And holy is the Holy Spirit. Amen? And so again, as they're sharing that over and over and over again. Because every time they fly by, they see something new and fresh to them. Something that they not have seen before. And it brings that holiness out in them. We have not even begun to understand, begin to comprehend, begin to unveil, begin to see Jesus for who he really is. Because if he did, we would be seeing signs and wonders like crazy. I truly believe that's coming whenever we get raised up. When we get raised up in the inside, our faith begins to build. We begin to want to go lay hands on folks. Begin to want to stop people in the street. Begin to want to see people brought and signs and wonders beginning to come to life. Because why? Because God's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Amen? Nothing has changed. The only one that's changed is us. We're scared that if we lay hands on somebody's going to say, what are you doing? Or if we lay hands on them, they don't heal, then, well, there you are. What are you? Lay hands on them again. Stretch that faith. As you stand to your feet now and they begin to play. I do want to share with you, too, that we have a cushion here that we'll lay on the floor down here. If somebody wants to come, just get on their knees before the throne or before the altar. And you just don't want to put your knees down on that hard floor, which is understandable. But there's that to get down on. Because I believe that there's some folks that need to pray. James shared with me this morning earlier. He said, there's a word that the Lord keeps laying on my heart. That word is freedom. Where are you at today? Are you free? Are you still being held in bondage? Do you want to be free? Are you waiting for Jesus like the bride? Maybe you just need to come down and get on your knees and get before God and tell him, that, Lord God, I know that my faith needs to be stirred up. There's a scripture in the Bible. You got to go to the new NIV. You're going to find it in New King James. I wish it was in the New King James. I'd share with you. It's in the NIV. You're spurring one another up. That's exactly what I try to do, James and I do, whenever we come here on Sunday, trying to spur you up. Trying to make you step into somewhere that you normally would not step. Encouraging you in such a way with the encouraging words that you hear, the songs that you sing, and the songs that you hear to carry you to a place where only God can help you go. Only a place of there where you can get out of from the frustration, you can get out of the bondage, you can get out of the shackles, you can get out of the prison, and you can get set free. But you've got to come to the one who set you free. Are you willing to come? Are you willing to step out and say, I'm tired of letting him hold me in bondage. I want freedom and I want it right now in Jesus' name. Will you come right now? If that's you. Don't let the enemy hold you in your place. People will move out of the way to come. Well, there's folks by me. Come on. Will you be part of this church that's waiting? Will you be ready? When the trumpet sounds, will you stand up? Or will you not even know it when it comes? Maybe you need to be anointed with some oil. Come on. Both of them?
Yeah, unfortunately.
She's having trouble with her legs, so we're going to pray for her legs, both of them.